In 1946, when Nuremberg was ongoing, I have hardly heard of Nuremberg, but my life was formed and inevitably altered by the Second World War. I was 9 when Nazi Germany invaded Poland, the country of my birth. Overnight, we became refugees. I survived in ghettos, hiding in lofts and cellars, and eventually was put in a forced labor camp. I was 15 when the war ended, with most of my family killed by the Nazis because they were Jews. I emerged from the war lucky to be alive, with too many painful memories, no education, and a hunger for school and normality. But an opportunity arose to leave for Palestine, where I had relatives, and those relatives enrolled me in high school. And my goal, which was not easy, was to catch up with my education, despite tremendous gaps in that education. The deprivations of World War II turned my craving for education into an obsession. And education opened the door to all that followed. War shattered my childhood, gave me a craving for education and a desire to use the law to bring an end to atrocities. War led to my legal opinion against the settlements. As professor, I taught the law of war. Interest in the origins of the law of war and the law of chivalry led me to an abiding fascination with Shakespeare's historical plays. Now, as a judge, I hear appeals concerning atrocities. In doing my work as a judge, in a principled way, come what may in terms of criticism, I am helping to strengthen the integrity of international criminal justice. And in years to come, I trust that others will see the first few decades of international criminal justice as a time when fledgling courts made profoundly important contributions to ending impunity and upholding human rights and human dignity. So as you see, my life has come a full circle. From World War II to trying war crimes and doing it justly and fairly. Looking back at my life, difficult as it may have been at times, I find comfort in the fact that throughout I have tried to stay on a moral course, wherever the winds may have been blowing. And I find comfort that, come what may, by way of challenges and criticism, international justice too has stayed and will stay its course. And I thank you.
Good evening, everyone. So glad that all of you have come here today for the Remembrance Day. 70 years ago, the World War II ended. Mr. Meron was one of the victims and also one of the survivors. My story is a similar story to his, only goes back 20 years. I'm going to bring you back first to 1982, the year that I was born, on the 31st of December, last day of a year. Poor mother of mine, no party, delivering me. I was born in a privileged family with money and opportunities in the former Bosnia, former Yugoslavia, now Bosnia and Herzegovina. All my future was bright. I was going to study, go to the university, and had all the chances that a man can have. But then, 1992 hit. I was 9, just like Mr. Meron, when the war started in former Yugoslavia. I was with friends of mine a weekend away in the mountains. It was a beautiful day. We had fun. And out of the blue, men came down, running from the mountains and hills and screaming, "You need to flee! The war is coming! The war is coming! You need to flee!" Her aunt and uncle picked us up, put us in a car, and brought us back to the center of Doboj, the city that I was born in. Our house was the first house behind the center mosque. I went in and I said to my parents, "The war is coming, the war is coming." And they were like, "Sit down, silly child of nine. Nothing is going to happen." 2 hours later, these same men went through Doboj with trucks behind them, saying, "The war is coming. Pack your kids. Flee now while you have the chance." Panic broke out. People ran into the trucks. Some took their children. Some forgot their children. No passports, no money, just fleeing for the war that was coming. My parents, "No, it's not possible that my neighbor, my best friend, my colleague could become my enemy in just one night and one day." And we stayed. We didn't stay in that house behind the mosque because they knew that that was going to be one of the buildings who is going to be bring down. So we went into the flats with friends and family. 7 days it took that Doboj was captured with bombs and grenades and snipers on the top of the buildings. After those 7 days, my parents still thought it's not going to take much longer. But we also ran out of clean underwear and socks. And my mother, she couldn't believe it still, but she also wanted to know how our house was doing, the house that my grandpa built with his bare hands. So with the snipers on the rooftops, she went to our house. Thank God she came back safe and sound. A few days later, we went back home. And the normal life began. The city was captured. It was still again. No bombs, nothing. And my parents didn't want to be in a war. So they just stood up the next day, got their clothes on, and went to work. My mother opened her saloon. My father worked at the customs and went to his job. And we, as kids, my brother and I, we went to school. For exactly 3 months, the normal life went on. After 3 months, my father once again woke up, put his clothes on, and went to work. On his way to work, he needed to cross the river Bosna. There was a bridge in Doboj, and there was a checking point. Two men checked his ID. One man knew my father, knew it was a good man, an honest man. And he said, "He's a good one." And my father walked on. The second man grabbed his gun and shot a bullet above my father's head and said, "They are never good enough." After that day, he went into hiding. I haven't seen my father for a year, from 92-something till 93. But not all my memories are horrific. I have also very beautiful memories of that war. Because I didn't have to go to school. My mother didn't have to work. My mother took the responsibility for all her our neighborhood, all the friends and old people living around. She collected medicine for them. My uncle had a big pastry with a lot of stock, flour, butter, honey. So we had no hunger. And all the people that we knew that had, we brought food. We brought medicine. And sometimes, hand by hand, we went through Doboj, into the mountains, to places that I didn't even know that existed, people that I didn't know that they existed. and we brought them something. My mother was a hairdresser, so she cut their hair. But there was no phone, no water, no food, mostly. But hygiene had to be taken care of. So we went out one day into the mountains, walked a long way. It was a beautiful, beautiful day, like this, somewhere in April or May. We went to a house of an old lady and an old man. My mother was supposed to cut their hair, but this lady didn't want me to sit there and wait. She said to me, come, come. And then she brought me to a little garden, a patio, in between the houses. So I was safe. And when she opened the door, there was a garden full of strawberries. She gave me a red bucket, and she said to me, you can pluck them, as many as you want, in this red bucket. And I was so happy. For the first time in such a long time, I had something great, something sweet, something such so beautiful. And the great thing was, she said, you can take the bucket with you to your house. And I said, oh, then I can share it with my brother. Because he stayed home with friends playing. My mother cut their hair. I got my red bucket. And then they said, it's about this same time, about 7. Stay here. Don't go back. You're a woman alone with a girl. You are going to be a predator. A victim. Don't go. Stay with us. And my mother said, no, I have my son. He doesn't know where I am, and I cannot leave him alone. So we went back. The next morning, I woke up. I went out playing with my Serbian friends, the Orthodox friends, because they become my friends. They came into the houses of my real friends who went away. And after playing, I came home. And my mother said, please sit down, I need to tell you something. The nice lady and the nice gentleman that we met yesterday, last night, they were slaughtered at their houses. And they hanged them up on their houses, like this, to prove to people what they are capable of. So my mother saved our life by not staying that night at that home. And these wonderful people gave me such a great gift, a gift of trust, of love, of having nothing to give, and still gave me that red bucket of those strawberries. And I have still my voice to tell their story. And the war went on and on. And after 1.5 years, the time came that the city needed to be cleansed. And genocide happens in different ways. Our way was that we needed to pay a lot of money to get on a convoy to move from Doboj to Belgrade, the capital city of Serbia. That meant for us that we are going to a lion's hole, not knowing if we're going to survive that trip. My father had great Serbian colleagues and friends. Whenever there were riots or razzias, they would warn us so we could hide ourselves. And also, when we were supposed to go on this trip, they stood there. There was a school playground where we all were collected. Our stuff was all looked upon. You weren't supposed to take any pictures. I was 10, and I had wonderful pictures of my last summer vacation, and I hid them in my bag. And I also prepared my own photo album to bring with me on the trip, not knowing where I was going, but I forgot that at home. But I did have those pictures, because pictures are also identificational material. But they didn't look into my bags. They did ask me if I had money. And my father gave me 100 mark, the German marks, and my brother too. And I said, no, I don't have any money. and thank God they believed me. If you can imagine, the convoy was like this room, full of people, packed with bags, old people, sick people, children, babies. There were three buses full. And then we sat on those buses, went to Belgrade. And just in front of Belgrade in Subotica, the friend, as it was promised to my father, was waiting for us. We got out and we were safe. We stayed at his house, and that night I was in the bedroom with my mother, and out of the blue, she started ripping her photos of when she was young. And she said, "I wish I wasn't born. I wish I wasn't born into this life." At that moment, my mother suffered a post-traumatic stress syndrome. The moment that she didn't have to survive anymore, that she didn't have to care for so many people, that she could cope and see what she has been through. And at that moment, I became her mother, and she became my child. On the convoy, when we were flying, there was this wonderful lady we met that my father worked with. She was living in Holland. She had a niece here also. And she said to my father, "I can arrange for you to get papers to move to Holland because you needed to be invited to come." We went to Belgrade, stayed with good friends of my father and mother. We're 4 months in hiding in their house. They were Serbs, took the risk for our life, for our safety, out of love and friendship, took very good care of us because there was nothing happening in Belgrade at that moment. It was beautiful weather, it was summer, and it was freedom. A freedom, my mother said, is something also what you need to learn. Being free when you have been captured for so long. After 4 months, the letter of invitation came. We got a visa and we came to Holland. And my parents needed to prepare us. What is that country, Holland, that we are going to? They said, "Everybody is walking in wooden shoes. There were going to be windmills everywhere, beautiful old windmills, cheese and tulips." We came 23rd of August to Rotterdam. You didn't walk in any of those wooden shoes. There were no tulips because the season is right now in April or May. And the windmills were the energy ones, you know? So my first day, I was already an illusion of armor. My trip, my first year Holland, was Rotterdam, Amsterdam, Zeewolde, Bloemendaal, Sassenheim. So we had a grand tour of this beautiful country. When we were in Zeewolde, we were in a big center, as it say, with a lot of different people. For the first time in my life, I have seen black people in real life. I only saw them in Miami Vice, in series we also watched in the 80s. Eh? But for the first time, I met different colors, different cultures, different people. I found it so incredible. We went to have dinner, and we got these papers, and on them they were stamped ontbijt, lunch, diner, breakfast, lunch, dinner. And my father said, "This is going to be for us our first three Dutch words. From now on, we are living in Holland, we're going to learn this language, and we are going to make this our own home country." And the rest is history. That's what happened. And one thing about that language, because it's a very hard language. We got a house in Sassenheim, in the Bollestreek, with all the tulips. And I went out for playing with friends. and we were playing soccer. And I said, schieten, schieten. Yes, so they started laughing at me. It's schieten. But at that moment, I decided, I was 10, maybe 11, I'm going to learn this language so good that when you hear me talk, you're never going to ever believe that I'm not Dutch. And thank God that also happened. But hey, when I say, my name is Leila, Leila Prnjavrats, the most people are like, huh? Leila, isn't that a Muslim name? Yes, it is. And what's your last name? Prnjavrats, the whole alphabet in there? Yes, it is. And I'm proud of it. And a beautiful thing to sum my full circle, like Mr. Meron did, I am also a mother now. I have a beautiful daughter with a husband from India who was adopted by Dutch people. So you can imagine in our relationship, I'm the Dutch girl and he's the foreigner. But it's the other way around. He's the Dutch guy, I'm the foreigner, and our daughter is called India. What I learned from my life and the experiences is that you always have to trust in yourself and always have to trust in others. You cannot do anything alone. What I have also learned is that it's important to be the one person who can make the difference for another person. And in my life now, I have got so many chances, so many opportunities. Work, I'm an entrepreneur for 7 years now. I have worked for national radio stations. I'm moderator. I do a lot of stuff, but a lot of stuff with youngsters, because my goal in life to be the one person who believes in them and to be the one person who can give them the stepping stone. And to finish and sum up with words of a wonderful lady, young lady, who had never had a chance, like myself, to be the voice of all those who cannot talk anymore, but who was a wonderful writer, whose book has gone all over the world. She said, "You will never get poor by giving." Anne Frank, World War II. Thank you very much.
Kabul, 1992. A small group of children were playing on the street when certain sounds in the distance disrupted their game. Sounds these little children were alien to. They all dispersed and ran towards their homes. I was one of those children. At age 5, I asked my parents what those sounds were and what they meant. I was naive. I had little things to cherish, little things to enjoy. I had no idea whatsoever what was happening outside. My mother said those were the sounds of gunfire, and I wasn't to play outside anymore. She was a teacher. My father was a brigadier in the army. They continued to go to work. And they instructed my elder siblings to create activities at home to keep us entertained until it was safe to go to the streets again. As days went by, there were more and more patriotic songs and national anthem being played on the radio. The sounds of gunfire were replaced by the sounds of rockets and bombs. We could hear and we could see planes fly over the city. We even witnessed a jet crash. At night, I remember the green lights in the sky. Rockets were being fired indiscriminately at all directions. We were seeking shelter in the basement of our home. When my parents felt that it was not safe to stay in our basement, our neighbors invited us to move to their basement to seek shelter. An hour after we leave the basement, a rocket hits the same basement we were staying at. We'd kept some chicken in the basement. They had died as a result. This bloody civil war spared nobody. We saw the government collapse. We saw different groups take over. We saw changes of regimes. My parents took the risk of traveling across the border to Pakistan, it's our neighboring country, to seek refuge with my grandparents, who had also fled the war in the south of Afghanistan. With a lot of difficulty, we arranged buses or cars. We made it to the other side of the border, where we spent several months in a village in the tribal regions of Pakistan without electricity, drinking water, and proper sanitation. My family decided that in order to seek a better living and pursue better education for us, we had to flee again, go to a better place. And they chose Islamabad, the capital of Pakistan, as a city which could provide us with those things. We moved to Islamabad as a young refugee at the age of 10. I started learning a new language, Urdu. I went to school. I worked at a grocery store with my brother. And as I grew older, I learned more and more about my home country, but never gone to Afghanistan. After the fall of the Taliban regime, many Afghans returned home from different countries, including some of my friends from Pakistan. So I visited Afghanistan after the fall of the Taliban regime and found it in more ruins and chaos than when I had left it as a child. In 2005, I found a job at the Afghan embassy in Islamabad, where I worked as a receptionist. Before reuniting with my family at the end of 2005 in Holland, my father and siblings had made separate journeys to Europe, most of which were dangerous journeys through different countries that I have never been to. In Holland, I found a job at a British company, which I gave up to study law at The Hague University. I'm perhaps the longest running student at the university, at the Faculty of Law. In 2012, I got an opportunity to do an internship with the Mission of Afghanistan to the United Nations in Geneva. And over the years, I was asking a lot of questions over my past and about my future. What was my past and where am I heading to? And usually dwelling about the past is counterproductive. It doesn't help when you think about your past. It doesn't help either when you prematurely think about things that await you. Nevertheless, I had these thoughts in my mind. I thought we have control over our thought processes, but I wake up to nightmares sometimes, still. In Geneva, I worked with the Department of Human Rights and Humanitarian Affairs. and I tried to seek answers to the questions I was asking. I met some ministers in the Afghan government who were not very keen to engage with me. I returned to Holland after finishing my internship, and last year I got an opportunity to work with the same mission again, resolved that I will find answers to my questions. I worked as a technical attaché, mostly at the Department of Human Rights. I worked with the Human Rights Council in Geneva. I don't know if some of you know the Human Rights Council. And I met a lot of lawmakers during my stay in Geneva, Afghan lawmakers who weren't very keen to engage with me either. So January this year, I got an opportunity to travel to Afghanistan. After 10 years, I got to see my friends, families. I got to see my homeland and chaos once again. Nothing had changed. Many Afghans, ordinary Afghans, as a result of three decades of war, are still suffering, including some of my friends and families. It hurt me to see children sell teas, water on the streets. A kid came to me when I was having a tea with a friend at a hillside. He said, "Have some tea." I said, "No, we're having tea. You see the pot and the tea." He goes, "No, maybe you need some more. Come on, take one cup." I said, "Kids, thank you very much. We have tea. As you can see, we haven't even finished the pot." He says, "No, think about it. Maybe you need one. Maybe you need an extra cup. Maybe you run out of it." And that's when I sensed the desperation in this child, that he was very desperate to sell me that one cup of tea. He could have been 9 or 10 years old. And that's when I broke up with my friend. And I thought, wow, after three decades of war, I had my dreams being shattered when I wanted to have a pedaled car for children. You sit in and you pedal with your feet, the car moves. When the war happened, that dream was shattered. I get very happy. It gives me immense pleasure when I see kids have different gadgets nowadays. It brings me a lot of happiness when I see kids possess the things that they want. But unfortunately, a lot of kids, including myself, their dreams are being shattered every day. And the little things that gives them joy and happiness, they cannot achieve. I returned to Holland about a month ago, resolved that I have to find new ways about questions of forgiveness, reconciliation, and justice. I think it's a great thing to remember war. It's a great thing to celebrate liberation, to celebrate peace. But I think as human beings, we have the responsibility to think further than only remembrance, further than only celebrations of peace. We need to seek new mechanisms. We need to seek new ways to prevent wars. We need to try new methods. We need to reach out and work together to to not let happen, not let war happen at first place, than to remember war and to celebrate peace after it. I'm resolved that I will find some methods in the years to come to prevent such atrocities that happened in Afghanistan and that are happening on a daily basis in other countries with the new wars. The famous poet Khalil Gibran said, "Keep me away from the wisdom that does not cry, the philosophy which does not laugh." And he also said, "Keep me away from the greatness which does not bow before children." I want to do something in the future, find ways to prevent dreams of children like myself and many around the world from being shattered once again. Thank you very much.
Kenya, pamoja, kwa upendo na amani, tuungane. Kenya, pamoja, kwa upendo na amani, tuilinde. Wa Kenya, pamoja, kwa upendo na amani tuungane. Kenya, pamoja, kwa upendo na amani tuilinde. Did you understand the song? Why are you clapping? Did you understand the song? Yeah? The song simply says that Kenyans, let's come together. Let's unite and rebuild our nation. For me, the song has a very nice tune. But it reminds me of the year 2007, when we, as Kenyans, faced the post-election violence. The year that we went through the polls, voted, waited for 24 hours, 48 hours for the results, waited and waited for the big result, the presidential result, only to turn into chaos. The post-election violence that came without any preparation, that came without any awareness, that all of us were not aware of. Kenyans stand against each other. Brothers, neighbors, friends, people we've all been living together, people you have gone to school with, people you trade together with, people you go to church together with, those you borrow things from every day, the person next to you turned against you, and you turned against them. people turned into animals. Friends suddenly became enemies just because of election. It's so crazy to see how something small like election can make people turn against each other. It's so sad to see people turning against each other just like that. I was there. I saw it all. I saw people killing, stoning, slaughtering people like animals, and their bodies scattered all over the streets that you can barely walk or drive through. You had to take your time to remove the bodies, or otherwise be killed in the process of removing the bodies, and your body used as one of the barriers. It was so sad to see all those bodies. Our mortuaries were fully packed. Fully packed with small toddlers, small children, women, young men of this nation who had a lot of future for the nation, who had a lot of dreams that were shattered down. All their bodies lying on top of each other in the mortuary. No space. You open the door, and only the bodies come down. No space. The smell. You could feel it, you could smell it, you could see. Two months after the violence, I wondered how we uselessly killed and slaughtered each other because of just a vote. I tried to pick up myself, pick up my talent, my calling, that is performance. I tried to make performances that could speak to people, to come together, to unite, to avoid this kind of, I don't want to say nonsense, this kind of fighting and violence against each other. So I made performances together with my people and went out to the community to initiate dialogue with each other. Performances about post-election violence. I made this one inspired me further to make performances addressing other issues like domestic violence, issues like child abuse, and currently issues like radicalization of our young people, and on to address other issues that we face in our community. Last Thursday, I had the privilege and opportunity to meet with President Meron. I hope you all know him. Allow me to say that he's a young man. You may laugh, but it's true. Looks old, but he's a young man. Because I'm very sure, as the age he is now, he's 84 years old, he should be relaxing somewhere in the house with newspapers. But he has chosen to continue fighting for the international justice, for the justice of people like us in other countries that are still going through different problems in their countries. I was so much encouraged by President Meron. I'm personally not 84 years old. You can see that, yeah? Still handsome, very young. But sometimes I get tired of all this violence. I get tired. And just wondering, I mean, when will it stop? When will it just relax and say we have peace? When will you come out of your house and not think that something can happen and you die just like that? When will you sleep in peace and wake up in peace? This sometimes makes me so sad makes me get even older. But people like Meron are here to inspire us. They are here to give us future, to give us hope for the future. It really inspired me so much that even as he's 84, there's still too much problems in this world. There's too much injustice going on. And I think it takes just one person like him and me and one more person to continue the wheel rolling, the wheel of acquiring justice for our people. I have a dream that I want to share with you. I believe in economic empowerment, economic independence of our young women. And I believe that if you empower young woman, just one young woman, then you will have empowered 10 other young women because they have that heart of helping each other, giving back, helping other fellows of theirs. And my dream is always in contributing to this global peace for our people, is to start a small kitty where our young girls, especially in East Africa, can get some small help to start their own enterprises. Then they'll become independent. Then they'll not be abused by their fellows, their men, and people like that. So they can be able to be economically independent. And that is my dream, to see that our people, our young girls, are economically independent, because they go through a lot of problems, and it's not easy to recognize this. So for me, that is what I'm going to do. And I know you're going to do something that you're not going to tell me, but you know it in your heart. Please do it. And if you can help me do my dream, help me. If I can help you do your dream, please tell me, and I'll help. So let me play this drum. Because in this drum, I see hope for the future for my country. In this, the beat of this drum always gives me some hope in life. And the rhythm always reminds me that as a nation, we can always rise again, even if we burn our country that we have built for over 45 years into ashes. We can always pick the pieces and rebuild our nation once again. So let me play this rhythm. Hold your neighbor. If you believe that we can all rise again and pick up the pieces of our nation and rebuild again. We mama, we mama, we mama, we mama, we mama, we mama, we mama. We mama, ah, we mama, oh, we mama, we mama, oh, we mama, ah, we mama, we mama, we mama.
Wow.
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 So they can sing.
Yeah. Very beautiful. And we were united, eh?
I think so. I think
all these beautiful people, one and another holding hands.
Yeah.
I love
it's
your
story. It's a good sign of unity. It's a good starting point. Because if you unite with one person, then it means you can even bring your enemies closer.
Definitely. And enemies you only have if you have also loved someone.
Yes.
Then you can hate.
Yeah.
So it always starts with love, and hopefully we can keep it in the love.
Yes, and there's always a very thin line between love and hate.
Very thin line. We have until 5 to 8, because I think we all want to have the 2 minutes of silence at 8 o'clock. Borders of forgiveness. If you have any questions to one of us, or you just want to share something in that matter, please do, because it's not something only happening over here. We are all united. So, to start off, you also told us that you had such a wonderful experience with Mr. Meron. You said it was like a young
for
soul.
For me, it was a new page in my life. I say it's like my second book in life, because he opened a new book for me, because I talked to him. It's such an inspiration to talk to him, because he looks young. And for me, I saw in him is for me to go and advise my fellow young men who are still sitting and relaxing, wasting their energy, that time is catching up with them. So they rather start using their youthful energy now than even later. So he really inspired me a lot, especially to continue fighting for international justice.
Beautiful. Is there someone with a question? Don't be shy. Just ask. I can come with a microphone, you can just say it. Yes, thank you.
So in about 26 minutes, we have 2 moments, 2 minutes of silence, which is a very big issue in the Netherlands, and we commemorate the last war that the Netherlands has been through. How do you relate to our history as connected to your own? I mean, you're all living in the Netherlands now. How do you relate to this history that we are officially commemorating at 8 o'clock? What does it mean to you?
Let me start. I mean, for Holland, you might be remembering war, but I think war and violence are all the same. For our countries, especially in Africa, we still go through this violence every day. And I think if you can only learn from countries like Holland, I mean, you see this country, you drive through very super nice highways, sit in the train, it's very sweet, you can sleep. I mean, I'd love like to literally copy paste Holland and put it in my country. It's only that I cannot. But I think it's just about the minds of our people. So I think for us to do it on this day, especially this kind of a talk, is to also get experiences from you guys, so that we can always replicate the same in our developing countries. You've gone so far, and I think we can learn a lot from Holland. That's why for me, I don't stay here, but I usually come so often too. I'm in love with the country, so that's, for me, I think it's that's my
take. And I think wherever injustice and suffering happens, it affects all of us. It affects all human beings, wherever they are. Whether it's war in a certain country, it's not that the people in peace in a peaceful country would say, okay, we're at peace, you know. We sympathize with them, but we can't stop our celebrations, we can't stop our parties, and etc. So that sense of humanity is there with everybody, irrespective of their nationalities, irrespective of the borders. And so there's always a connection between how you remember victims of war. For me personally, they're all the same. Doesn't matter the wars happened 200 years ago or last year, they were victims of war. And I pray to them. That's the only thing I can do.
And for me, it gave me permission, because 11th of May, my mother has died, so May is always a very special month for me. And the 4th of May, it gave me the permission to talk about all that has happened and is still happening. Because in my country, it's not that simple and often that it happens that you can talk about what you have gone through. And I love the fact whenever I get invited to talk about it, because I am the voice of all of them that are not able to speak. I have survived, and I can go on for my mother and for all those wonderful people. So once I wrote that I was coming here, and one of my Bosnian friends said, "You are our sunshine." And I found that such a beautiful compliment, because I don't mind telling my very personal stories, full of pain and also full of love, because I want to be one of those people who take the next step. And I'm not afraid. I am not a victim. When people tell me I'm a victim, I'm not. I'm a survivor. Please don't call me a war victim. And that's why I love the fact that we have 4 and 5 of May, so that we can share with one another, that I can say this is how I feel about something, and this is how I want to be treated. And I can use my voice, nothing else but that voice. So that's what it means for me. Thank you for the question. Thank you. Yes.
Yeah, well, all of you have seen a lot of violence, a lot of cruelty, a lot of people suffering. And how did you turn all that hate back into love? You say hating, in fact, start with loving. But when you are hating, how do you turn it back into love?
You see, if I can start by the saying of Mahatma Gandhi, who once said that only the weak cannot forgive, and that forgiveness is an attribute of the strong. So I think in that kind of, coming from the environment that we've come from, sometimes it's hard to say who really did what and when. And then everybody then becomes a victim. Either you can never be on the opposite side. If you're wrong, then you're all wrong. If you're right, then you're all right. Because look at Kenya in 2007. Who do you pick? Who will you pick? Nobody. Then it's only easy if you can forgive and forget and move on. Otherwise, you're going to stuck. You're going to be stuck there trying to look. I mean, if you can only forgive and forget and move on, then that's how, I mean, that's the spirit that we need, especially in this day.
And I've never hated anyone.
Me neither.
That's because I don't know that word. It's very difficult maybe to understand, because I've gone through very terrible stuff. But my predators and the people who killed the group that I was from, the people were also the ones who saved us. So who can I hate? For me, there's a good soul, a good human being, or someone who is afraid, insecure, or I don't know, whatever, that goes to the bad side. That's the only thing how I look at the world. And I try not to talk in groups, but in a person, a soul, a human. And that's, for me, how to explain. I have never hated anybody.
We were born with love, all of us.
Yeah.
And our experiences diminish the amount of love for something, but the love stays there. It's not that the love was gone. We only learn to move on. And in the case of experiencing war, as Harrison was saying, you cannot recognize the perpetrators of the war to really hate them. And even if you do, hate is not the way
to move forward. Hate is not the way to solve the problems.
It eats you up.
There's no hate. No.
Hate eats you up.
Yeah, that's it.
You were with a question, second one. I have seen, then you, and then you, so, yeah.
How do you think about the prosecution of war criminals, or whatever you like to use? For example, in Bosnia, prosecution in the slave tribunal?
I've been there, by the way. A good friend of mine works at a Yugoslavia tribunal. And he said to me, like, do you want to come and see one of those judgments? And I said, yes, why not? So I brought my passport and I got that visitor's thing. And I went in. It was with Mladic, by the way. And I sat there in a group. There was also a class of youngsters studying law. There was one sleeping. So the man who is of the security woke her up and said, go home. And we were sitting there. This was our history, and she was sleeping. So you see that can be like total different worlds. And I sat across him, and it did nothing. I felt nothing. I just sat there and I thought, he's an empty shell. And he doesn't do anything to me. That's it.
If I get you right, you're asking about how do we feel about international prosecution and stuff of people who have committed war crimes or crimes. And for me, coming from East Africa, and you know, for example, you know Kenya in relations to ICC or in relations to The Hague. And by the way, The Hague in Kenya sometimes is a very feared name. Yeah, attached to the issue of prosecution of powerful people. So for me, as long as I also want to see justice for our people, because surely how can you replace your mother or your sister or your brother or your husband who was slaughtered and killed? How do you replace that? So so long as I also want international, I want justice for the people, for the victims, for me and for my country, I think the process also should be so clear to our people. And I don't blame them for this. It's because the international law, sometimes it's not easy to understand those terms, those languages, the procedures, the hierarchy and the stuff. Sometimes it's not easy to understand. So I don't blame our people for sometimes rebelling. It's because they don't understand. So I would like them to understand these processes, how it works, so that they accept and embrace justice, because I believe if justice is done to you, then at least sometimes even become more easy. Yeah. So, yeah, I recognize it's a noble idea, and sometimes I like how the West do it. When you just mention like, oh, you stole this money, then you step aside, or you kill this person, you step aside. Our people will never step aside until you really grab them out of the power. So it's still a long process for us. But we are getting there, and for our people.
Like President Meron just said, that in the coming decades, we'd see how we can safeguard justice in the international criminal justice system. So, in my opinion, it's the beginning. You know, we've come a long way, but I still think it's steps. First steps towards something bigger in the future. But it all depends on us. If we want to make it, if we don't politicize it, then it will ultimately lead somewhere for the betterment of everybody. And I hope, and I'm confident that that's what they are doing now. We just have to be patient for our children to see justice in the future.
Just a quick one, if you see the example of Rwanda, where it was difficult to say who did what and when. see everybody said we are all guilty, and then we are all sorry. Let's start from here and go forward. Because if you start really thinking about the past, then you're not going to move. You see, Rwanda right now is like the Europe of Africa. It's very clean. People are very mature. And for me, I think that's where we should all, if it doesn't work, the law doesn't work, if it takes too much time and too much energy and reminds you every now, because these processes takes 20 years, and I mean, a lot of years. So every time you hear the court is going on, you start remembering, oh, every time you hear this person is going to the court, you start remembering, what again? But if you cannot say, okay, we did it. Yes? Yes, we did it. Can we move on? We are sorry. Can we move on? Yes. For me, that's, I mean, it's also a good, a powerful way of starting a new life.
Yeah. First, I would like to thank you all for the stories you shared. But I have a question for Harrison. How precisely do you see performance art actually helping issues as violence or violence against women?
Yeah, I talked about it last week. But as I was putting it in my speech, I think at the moment you cannot separate performing arts because it's and development, because actually they are the same thing. You need performing arts, you need theater for development. Because for example, there's some issues that we call them human factors in development. The feelings of people. Sometimes you can only touch them through a very nice play. Sometimes if you tell some people some issues, if you confront them directly, then there's always going to be some kind of resistance and violence again. And for example, the issue of extremism, like we have some Muslim leaders who are also like giving some information to young people, and then they come radical and start killing people. How do you confront that? You go to him and start saying this and this. You can put it through a play, talk to them, just engage them, start discussing, find why and what. So for me, I think performing arts and life is same line. You can use it also for international justice to explain to people what it really means. We can use it in addressing domestic violence. Maybe you can refer to my last speeches on YouTube. Hague Talks, Harrison.
He has such a part. Yeah. Oh, great, beautiful. You, and then I think that's going to be the last question, if we have time, because we have Taco, Zorgdrager. Pretty heavy name for a day today. I know. I've seen the gentleman. If we have the time, 5 to 8, we're gonna give him the stage. So if we have the time, we'll go to you. And otherwise, we're after this all, we'll have a drink and a moment to talk. So you can directly ask us whatever you want. So you know.
And you can also ask them, eh?
My question was indeed also what has been asked before. It's like, as a nation, not as a person, but as a nation, how do you get past all this? Because, you know, this war and violence, it breaks, let's say, trust between people, and it breaks the social fabric. So what I'm asking, basically, is how do you get over it within you, as a nation? And related to that, you talked about how there's been a Yugoslavia trial, and there has been something in Kenya, but Afghanistan decided not to do anything about it. How do you?
Absolutely, I agree. I think it's very difficult. It's rather complex to make it work together after going through a lot, like you said. War gives birth to many other diseases, such as corruption, lack of rule of law, all sorts of injustices, and a lack of education. So, and when you have corruption, that I think corruption actually affects the social fabric of a society to begin with. So, in my opinion, post-war
development should focus on justice, but should also focus on the corruption that comes after war. I think in the case of Afghanistan, I won't make claims, but if we resolve the corruption issue, even say by 60 to 70%, by 50%, we'll see a lot of development and we'll see trust. We have, I mean, our nation, Afghans, they trust each other, but it's time, like Harrison said, we have during elections, we also begin to mistrust each other on ethnic lines and on ideologies and etc. So, yeah, in my opinion, solve corruption, you solve many trust issues.
Yes, and if I reflect on Bosnia, the difficult part is the fact, and I think that all of us was talking about it, is that this is the war is between sometimes friends, acquaintances, people you know. The war that was here was with Germans. They invaded this country. I cannot say to my neighbor, go to your country. You know? So it's very difficult. My friend, she was raped. When she goes to the grocery store, she meets him every time. My father was beaten in front of the mosque. When he goes to our city, he sees the man who beat him. So that's the thing, I think, the most difficult part. And that's why I love what you said, like, let's accept the fact that we need to move on. And that's also like we need to forgive. Otherwise, you cannot go on. And I think that that's one of the difficult part of the wars that we were in, is that you cannot, like, say, go to your own country. Because that land, that country, is from all of us. I'm getting signs clearly here. Sorry, sir. You can just come up later to us, because I want to give Taco, let's take our chairs away, the stage, Taco Zorgdrager, Aid Keeper. If we translate it in English, your last name, it's very...
Caretaker.
Caretaker, yeah, thanks. A beautiful poem about children. Just please stand in front of the letters.
That's right.
You're a tall... Thank you. A warm applause, please.
Thank you. I'm not standing here as a refugee. I have no first-hand experience with war, only second-hand experience of the effects of war through my parents and my grandparents who survived the Japanese concentration camps and labor on the Burma railway. And ironically, you could say my Jewish grandmother was very lucky she was in Indonesia at the time, because if she would have stayed in Europe, I probably wouldn't have stood here right now. I'm going to read a poem for you in Dutch. Not read, but recite. Yeah, that's right. I tried to translate it in English, and you have it there. It is not an exact translation, but it is actually rewritten. The poem was performed as a part of a location theater project here in The Hague around Easter. I don't know if you know the location, the Waterpartij. It's a park with two lakes. Viewed from the top, the lakes have the shape of an ear. And the purpose of this theater project was to create an inner quiet in an outer room. the audience had to walk around the lakes, and underway they would encounter theatrical moments, dancers, music, silence, a choir, a children's choir, etc. During the process of making this theater program, we discovered that there had been a house located at the pond. This house was built before the Second World War, but at the eve of the Second World War, refugee children, Jewish children from Germany and Austria were sheltered there in that house. Nobody knows about that anymore in The Hague, which is very strange. And we discovered it through the work of Miriam Kasing, who is a researcher on Jewish refugee children in the Netherlands and where they have been put. 150 children were staying there for not so very long, because in 1941 already the Germans decided they had to be moved and the house was demolished for the Atlantikwall. There are not many survivors of these children. A few and the other were deported to the concentration camps. We decided, when we discovered the existence of this house and of these children, that we wanted to include them somehow in our performance, because it is now an empty place where some trees grow and nothing reminds of their existence there. And so I tried to write a poem, and the poem was spoken right at the place where the house was built. I put it on myself or something. Okay. Actually, I think it is a kind of prayer, the poem. Trying to transform commemorating into the will to change how we look at life. And so, before the poem started, I carried a woman on my back. Ah, there are the children. It's one, a rare picture of them. I carried a woman to the place and put her down there. She was like the embodiment of the memory of that place. Wie ziet hier in het zonbeschenene nog sporen van het licht dat in hun ogen glanzend stilstond boven adem die al maar uit en binnen trok. Van kindermonden zingend met handen aan hekken geklemd, of los als wind aan hemel gehecht. De altijd muziek in hun denkende hoofden, vol tover van het nog onbeschenen zijn. Geen fluistering meer is er over. Het gras dat hun afdrukken droeg, verdween met de tijd. Blijf bij ons, licht van de aarde. Blijf bij ons, licht van de aarde, dat wij zelf maken, uit al het onvoltooide dat zich in ons voltrekken wil. Wij zijn het licht van de aarde, steeds komend en dovend in golven van tijd, die met ons verschijnen, die in ons verdwijnen. Zoals alles verdwijnt wat wij verlaten. Wat blijft is de gloed van onze gaven. Hier waren zij samen, losgeweekt van plaatsen die zij thuis noemden en van elkaar niet kenden, waarnaar geen terugkeer was, waarna geen terugkeer is. Als de boeg splijt, is de reis voorbij. Blaas leven in het zeil en beman de uitkijk. Altijd op weg naar de aarde die wij bevaren. In onze handen ontwaakt een horizon.